I'm not gonna lie. This is without a doubt the hardest review I've ever had to write. I've been conflicted on this from the first moment I stepped into the snow. But in the end, despite all the things it gets right, Red Dead Redemption 2 gets so many more things wrong, disastrously wrong, that I simply can't bring myself to turn a blind eye this time. As nonsensical and ludicrous as this may sound to all of its adoring fans, Red Dead Redemption 2 is a horrible game disguised as a great one, and it is my unfortunate task to point it out. And if you believe nothing else I'm about to say, believe this. No one is more pissed off about it than I am. Red Dead Redemption 2 is actually a prequel, or a pre-sequel, if you want to use Gearbox terminology. It tells the backstory of the infamous Vanderlyn gang and John Marston's involvement in it that leads up to the plot of Red Dead Redemption. It's essentially an open-world action RPG. Think Witcher 3 in the Old West, or at least, that's what it wants to be. In reality, it's just Grand Theft Auto set in the Old West, bringing with it all the problems of the GTA series along with it, and some new ones. Okay, let's get this over with. We're gonna do it by the book. Graphically, Red Dead Redemption 2 is mostly a feast for the eyes. Its environments are breathtaking to behold, especially considering the size of the map. The dynamic weather and day-night system adds to the mystique of it all. I honestly got more enjoyment from just roaming around looking at the world they created than any other aspect of the game. The character design is also superb. I just wish the animation matched its quality. Many of the animations seem directly ported over from Grand Theft Auto. The credits list a whole team dedicated to motion capture, but the facial animation more resembles something animated by hand, and most of the characters still have that dead eyes, uncanny valley look that's also prevalent in BioWare's games. Overall, it's behind the quality of facial animation seen in Uncharted 4, or the footage shown of The Last of Us 2. The animals are well animated, but the humans have some really wonky stuff going on from time to time. The animation used for running downhill, for example, ends up looking like the crab walk glitch from Mass Effect Andromeda and caused me to laugh out loud on more than one occasion. The voice acting is all superb, though there were a couple of southern accents that rang fake to my ear here and there. The musical score is mostly top-notch, though there were a number of big shootouts and action scenes where the score seemed unusually subdued in tone considering the action on screen at the time. Similar to some of the fights in Halo 3 where you had this trippy Tangerine Dream synth stuff playing while you were blowing aliens' heads off. But for the most part, they got it right. And that ends the positive things I have to say about the game. Now it's time for the rest. Tighten your stirrups. This is gonna get bumpy. The controls are horrible. I don't know what it is about Rockstar, but they've never been able to build a decent control system for third-person shooting mechanics. It's sloppy and unresponsive as hell. I've seen various recommended control settings that are supposed to lessen the issue, but none of them really did anything for me. I can best equate how bad it is in the following way. Remember the horrible dead zone and sluggish aiming in Uncharted 3 before they patched it to include classic aiming? Yeah, this is even worse than that was. And Rockstar clearly knew it was bad too, since auto-aim is enabled as default when the game starts, and it certainly needs it. I don't care for auto-aim personally, because it typically always aims straight to the gut. So what I had to do to compensate here was snap to the gut, flick up, and fire for the headshot. There's also the Deadeye system, but I hardly ever had to use it since I was pulling off headshots or double gut shots fast enough where it wasn't needed for most situations. And even so, there were several fights in the game where the Snap 2 auto-aim simply stopped snapping. At first I thought it was maybe that my endurance was low or something, but no, it just randomly stops working. There was one scene during the final fight of the game where three men were standing at the crest of a hill not far from me at all, and not only did the Snap 2 auto-aiming just die all of a sudden, but it wouldn't even give me a red reticle indicating that it was registering them as targets at all. I had loads of ammo, and I tried it with every gun I had on me, and it just would not target them, manually or otherwise. So in the end, I ended up having to let them kill me and reload from the checkpoint, and then, wouldn't you know, it magically started working again. Movement in general is a pain as well, as there seems to be an overall half-second lag. If you press right, there's half a second, and then the character moves. It doesn't matter if you're on foot or on horseback. I also ran into a lot of contextual failures where they've assigned so many multiple functions to the same button that the game would habitually get confused. The worst example of this, by far, is the cover system. Half the time it wouldn't register me wanting to go into cover in the first place, and sometimes, instead of going into cover, he'd climb on top of the cover instead. This most often occurred on uneven ground when I was trying to take cover behind a boulder or a crate. Instead of ducking behind it, there he'd go, climbing right up on top of it and standing there like a fool hoping to get shot. Suicide by cowboy for the win, y'all. Don't even get me started about the AI. On a consistent basis, I was able to walk right up to guys, stand right next to them while they were firing away at someone else in the gang, take a bead on them, and just stand there for several seconds without them even bothering to turn and look my way before I blew their brains out. I only had one or two occasions where they ever even tried to flank me or sneak up behind me. The rest of the time it was gun-based whack-a-mole, just waiting for them to pop their head up so I could pop it off. The fast travel system is a joke. First of all, you have to invest a ton of money into the camp to even get it, which is a joke in and of itself considering that it's supposed to give you all these great benefits, but I'll get to that in a minute. Once you do get the fast travel system, it's only available when you go to Arthur's area in the camp and look at a map tacked to the back of his wagon, or on the wall when they're in the mansion. Thing is, once you fast travel to where you're going, there's no way to fast travel back to the camp when you're done, or fast travel to another town. You have to take the damn scenic route every time. This results in the vast majority of your gameplay being spent just riding your horse from one place to the next. Oh sure, you could take a train or a stagecoach, but of course you'll first have to ride your horse to a train station or a coach station, and since most of those are in the towns where most of your objectives take place anyway, that doesn't help you out at all. And speaking of towns, did any of you notice that you travel through all these towns where you can interact with dozens of NPCs, especially in Saint-Denis, but when traveling around these towns, you see one or two cabins, a ranch or plantation here and there, maybe a cluster of shacks or even a shanty town. But where the hell do all these people live? Do they live in their theaters, banks, sheriff stations, train stations, and so on? And if so, why do you never see their beds or wardrobes in said businesses when you're robbing them or walking around in them? And why are there no outhouses behind the buildings? Where in God's name do these townsfolk shit? There's several mini-games throughout to kind of stave off the monotony, but only cards and dominoes are really any fun. Fishing is bland, generic, and boring. Aside from being able to fish from a boat, it's little different from the fishing minigame in Final Fantasy XV, and you already know how I feel about that game. The knife game is just a rhythm and memorization thing, almost like playing Simon if losing got your finger stabbed. One of the gameplay's biggest failures is the systemic padding that's going on, all to give the game the illusion that it's a lot more immersive than it actually is, because they don't affect the outcome as much as they're meant to, if at all. You can purchase new weapons and upgrade them, but I played through the majority of the game with the same pistol and rifle and had very little difficulty or challenge, short of turning auto-aim all the way down. I also never had to clean my gun, despite the game telling me I needed to regularly. I never experienced any issues with my aiming or rate of fire because of this. You have systems for changing your clothes, beard, hairstyles, all ostensibly to make you harder to recognize when you're wanted. But it never did any good. I'd go into town, get in a shootout, the whole area would turn red, I'd leave, change my clothes, shave all my hair and my beard off, and then just be moseying along on a dirt road on my way to town, and then I'd hear, "There he is, boys! That's the sumbitch what killed my pawpaw! Get him!" But if I left, went to another town, paid the bounty and went back, it was all, howdy, mister. Or I could just move on to the next chapter and come back later and everything was okay. The only exceptions were the old fort up near the top of the map and Blackwater, which was insta-death for most of the game. So you're supposed to donate money to the camp to upgrade it and keep everyone healthy and happy, right? The upgrades are supposed to give you all these perks and what have you, but short of the aforementioned broken fast travel system, I saw no benefit to donating money. I never went hunting or fishing to get food for the camp, yet no one starved to death, no one complained, no one left the group over it, or even had a nasty word to say about it. I never needed ammo or tonics because I always picked those up off the corpses of the men I shot. I never did bounties outside of what the plot required because the stuff you could buy was worthless anyway, so I didn't need the money. And every time I went back to camp, everyone was fed and happy, but the money I donated to the camp never dropped, indicating that they were not spending the money I donated to maintain their supplies. It's an utterly pointless system to make you feel like you're an important cog in the gang's machine, but ultimately it accomplishes nothing. You have all these legendary animals you can hunt, but I only killed four of them, none of which were a challenge since I dropped them with my volcanic pistol from 70 feet away before they even saw me. I didn't kill any more than that because taking their items back to the fence to craft the perks was a joke. Almost all of the perks are related to improving all these meaningless subsystems I never even needed to use in the first place, so what was the point besides earning a trophy? I'm supposed to keep myself well fed, my horse well fed and rested, and so on, but short of being near death, I never ate anything. I never fed my horse. I never petted him or cleaned him. I never bought new horses for that matter. If one died, which happened a lot, usually because the procedural NPC placement loved putting a guy on a horse just over the crest of a hill directly in my path as I was galloping at full speed, or I was too far away to call mine to me, I just stole someone else's and rode off with it. I never made camp out in the wild. I never had to craft ammo or anything else unless the storyline required it. I occasionally slept just to get back to daytime to go on a mission, but that's it. And as far as I can tell, it had absolutely zero effect on the gameplay. If I can beat the game without having to do any of those things, how about just not having them in there at all, and not having horse testicle physics for that matter, since they're hidden behind the horse's tail 99% of the time, and just put all that dev time into better facial animation and a functional control scheme? Hell, there's probably systems in that game I don't even know about because I never had a need to use them. The game also has a lot of glitches to it. Men who were supposed to be sitting on logs were instead hovering 6 inches above them. Men riding invisible horses, NPCs falling into seizures or spontaneous breakdancing, hitting a guy with a train so hard he flew off into the distance and disappeared from view, getting stuck inside the scenery, invisible guns or guns that floated in front of you instead of in your hands, you know, real Bethesda type shit. The only stereotypical glitch I didn't experience was the good old falling through the floor routine. But the game only crashed on me once, so I guess that's something. Finally, and most disturbingly, there's the story. I've seen so many people praising the story to this game, and it just boggles my mind. First of all, it suffers from the same problems as any prequel because you already know which characters will still be alive by the end of the game, particularly John Marston, his wife and son. When Jack gets kidnapped, for instance, there's zero tension because you know Jack survives. It structurally borrows from the previous game as well, since both end the main story with a character sacrificing himself to save someone he cares about, with the epilogue focusing on that person building his life and then seeking revenge for the one who saved him. And both games stop the plot dead in its tracks to take you to another environment entirely for this long, drawn-out, pointless subplot. For the first game, it was Mexico. For the sequel, it's an island off the coast of Cuba. And remember how I said most of the game is just riding your horse? Well, much of the character development and backstory takes place in conversations on said horse rides. clippity-clopping across the plains as hop-along exposition tells you about exciting events instead of, you know, getting to actually play them. The rest of the structure of the plot is so cookie-cutter that it's downright laughable. The same pattern repeats over and over again, with only the final chapter, the epilogue, and the brief excursion to Cuba to offset the repetition. Go on a heist. Someone on the team either fucks up, double-crosses the gang, or it's a trap. Gang packs up their crap, moves to the next town. They go on another heist. Someone zigs instead of zags. Someone you thought was your friend stabs you in the back. It's a trap. Gang packs up their crap, moves to the next town. It's the same thing, over and over again. By the time it happened 4 chapters in a row, I was just ready for the game to be over, didn't even give a shit how it ended. A guy like Arthur Morgan, who had a reputation for being ruthless, would have broke ties or killed Dutch by the 3rd fuck-up. I don't care how much he liked him. Every time one of Dutch's lackeys ran up to me and said, "Arthur, Arthur, I got some info on a new score. This time it'll be flawless," I just wanted to blow his teeth out the back of his skull. I found myself yelling at Arthur and trying to shoot Dutch 3 chapters in, and it wouldn't let me. Now that would have been something. You decide early on that Dutch is a moron, so you splatter his brains across the prairie, and then are presented with a whole different set of events. It's not like that would be a huge innovation after all. Even Marvel Ultimate Alliance 2 gives you the ability of siding with Cap or Tony, which totally changes the plot of the game. The Infamous games were able to manage this too. Why couldn't I ram a white-hot cattle brand up Dutch's ass, slaughter the whole gang, skin them all, then sell their man pelts to the wrong-turners living in the caves and/or swamp, and become the lone outlaw? At least it would have been something different. Arthur, both as a character and as a performance, is totally wasted on this assembly line plot. I swear, Dutch and Micah are the dumbest Western villains to hit the screen in decades. You might as well have been following Sheriff Taggart around and taking orders from Hedley Lamarr. But that's not even the half of it, folks. This plot not only rips off its own predecessor, it's basically the video game equivalent of a best of clip video from every decent Western movie over the last 60 years, maybe even farther back than that. After all, where else have we seen a villain dumber than a bag of horse shit? That's right. Where else have we seen the most interesting character in the game get killed off by tuberculosis before the last fight of the story? That's right. Where else have we seen a child kidnapping leading to a harrowing rescue? That's right. Where else have we seen cannibals munching their way across the West? That's right. Where else have we seen a tribe of Native Americans rely on a wayward white man to save them from another white man? That's right. Where else have we seen a heist involving a poker game on a riverboat? That's right. Where else have we seen a wanted man take refuge working for a rancher, seeking revenge when his righteous benefactor's ranch is attacked? That's right. And for that matter, where else have we seen a group of allies remain loyal to their leader despite him being arguably insane? That's right. Where else do we see a train robbery where they rob the train by blocking off the tracks right down to the same damn camera angles? That's right. Where else do we see a man with a cloudy past save the people of a corrupt mining town from its evil owner? That's right. Where else have we seen a bad guy who dresses and acts much like Dutch and has the last name of Marston, for fuck's sake? That's right. Come to think of it, doesn't Dutch also kind of seem eerily similar to... That's right. Where else have we seen a badass, smart mouth, marginally unhinged female gunfighter? That's right. Where else have we seen three-man stare downs? That's right. Where else have we seen bad men trying to do better in the name of the women who turned them from their wicked ways? That's right. Where else have we seen an epic gunfight that takes place at night at an old southern antebellum plantation? That's right. Where else have we seen cowboys square off against vampires? That's right. Where else have we seen a blending of the Old West and time travel? That's right. Where else have we seen a blending of the Old West and Jules Verne-ish robotic technology? That's right. Where have we seen aging outlaws struggling to adapt to the modern world and the dying Old West? That's right. And finally, I know this is a long-standing meme in Rockstar Games, but I don't give a shit. Where else have we seen cowboys run into space aliens? That's right. And just before I close things off, don't come at me with this crap about, well, you didn't play the multiplayer. Maybe the multiplayer just totally saves the experience. No. I have seen I don't know how many complaints already as the game sits in beta right now of people griping and bitching and hating it because it's essentially a pay-to-win factory for microtransactions. Not to mention the fact that there's a lot of rumors going around that when they reset the servers and take it from beta to live, everyone's gonna lose all the progress they made while playing the beta. Thank you so much, Rockstar. No review I've ever done has pained me or troubled me more than this one. I wanted so bad for this to be great. I had such high hopes for this game. And there are aspects of it that truly are nothing short of masterful, but try as I might, I cannot overlook the absolutely atrocious and unforgivable flaws with this game, so I have no choice but to give it the highest score I can give a game that earns the Don't Buy This Shit distinction. 1,000 Ways to Fuck Up the West gets a 4 out of 7. So how'd you like my review? Feel free to give me a like or a subscribe, those always help. In the description there are links to my store, my Patreon, and just about everything else that you could possibly think of to toss a little thanks my way. Feel free to check out some of my other videos, and until next time, show me your red, son!